got to do with anything. You ain't even complete that who you got yet. What you talking about?
I can explain. I go hard with it no matter how dark it is. I'm insane, but on my toes. I could keep the world balanced on my nose. I had a slumber party with all my foes. Now I wear them like a badge on all my clothes. If I'm crazy, I'm on my own. If I'm waiting, it's on my throne. If I sound lazy, just ignore my tone. Cause I'm always gonna answer when you call my phone. Like, what's up, danger? Okay, so if I'm being honest, first off, I was really excited for the Who You Got, right? A lot of stuff happened. For those of y'all who know, y'all know. For those who don't, maybe if we get close, I'll tell you. But granted, it's been a long time since I was supposed to do this video. One of the main reasons why I didn't, or like I'm not as excited as I was the last one, the Lemillion versus Pain, which is amazing, by the way, is I did this Who You Got during a stream. And people come to my stream, at least as of now, which is about 2022. 3, 5, 10 people at the most, but that's it. I feel like this would have been a lot funner if I do this when I get a larger audience, you know. So when I have people to bounce off and interact with. But next time I'll just do my next Who You Got, like my last video format. But for now, because I'm going to get this out, because Beloved will never let me hear the end of it, and because he's trash and he still sucks, I got to do this Who You Got. So without further ado, cue the Who You Got. We just finna do it. So, this Who You Got video is finna be, a 2v2. So, what I'm gonna try to do with every Who You Got video is give it a purpose, like a reason. So the last Who You Got video, in my opinion, was a little easier because it was a villain and a hero, right? It was Lemillion versus Pain. Pretty easy. Like, even though two different universes, it was a hero and a villain. So, like, the basis of the fight could be easily defined. It was a hero and a villain. The villain was doing villain stuff, and Lemillion came up and said, "Nah, bro, that gotta stop." We're gonna do, it's a 2v2, remember? So it's gonna be Yato, Yabuku from Noragami, and Bishamonten, or Vina, from Noragami. And if for those who don't know, Noragami is what I like to call one of those sleeper anime. So you looking at your boy Yato, right, whose real name is Yabuku, we will get to that, and Bishamonten, you know what I'm saying, that's kind of spoilers, they really don't be kissing like that, but you know what I'm saying, but Bishamonten, just so everybody get a glimpse of who we actually talking about here, and when I tell you this chick is a monster, bro, she's a monster, we finna get into that, but this ain't no joke. Like, I'm not even finna. She ain't no joke, okay? So we got Yato and this god, all right, versus from One Punch Man, definitely spelled that wrong, Atomic Samurai, right?
Bunch of Chad.
And Metal Bat from One Punch Man, he called him Chad, and Metal Bat. Yato, Bishamonten versus Atomic Samurai, Metal Bat. Who you got? That's what we need to know.
That's okay. Your man's man, so, right there.
Yo, dude is, and he ain't no joke. You know, I found out that his bat is actually literally unbreakable.
It has to be the way he be hitting people with it.
Facts, and we finna get onto that, right? So, to set the stage, actually, hold up. I hear my clothes going off in the background. Hold on. Gotta get that, because you know, dad mode activating. Hold on one sec. Talk to him a little bit.
don't know what he's expecting me to talk to you about. This is his thing. Yeah, I'm supposed to be in on part of it. But I ain't got stats for both of them.
Bruh.
So to set the stage, if y'all know the last time when I did the Who You Got, we had a specific stage. If you want to see about that, go check the Lamillion vs. Payne video. You know what I'm saying? But this one, we're going to set in Bleach's Soul Society. This is where this at right here. This whole fight taking place in Bleach's Soul Society. Why the Soul Society?
Why not just do Hell?
No. One, it's already made. You know what I mean? I already got the content. And I'm finna tell you why. That's why I told you wait for the fight part. You know what I'm saying? Okay, so the reason why we picked up this part right here is because, one, Shinigamis are deities at the point in time, right? Y'all gonna see in this Who You Got. Once again, in the last one, it was a bad guy versus a good guy. It's real easy to do. Bad guy was doing bad guy stuff. Good guy said, nah, you can't do that. They threw hands. You know what I'm saying? This isn't the case, so there has to be a stage set. And essentially, even though it's not where Bishamonten them go, they would have a place similar to this. And if y'all know how we do...
Get your her deep throat in their mic.
you don't have... I don't want the same place to fight to be in one of the respected universes of these people. So, Soul Society. Also, a big thing on this was, is there a way for humans, which is Atomic Samurai and Metal Bat are, to get the Soul Society? Yes. Blast. Y'all don't know Blast.
Die.
He's supposed to be the number one hero.
They die.
And who dies? No. this man. Over here.
Sorry.
No, you're good. But Blast can actually transcend dimensions. We're going to get into that here in just a second, okay? So,
what the fuck?
Another reason why, because technically here there's not going to be human-based casualties, which is something that they both don't want. You can technically die in the Soul Society, but once again, it's a different universe. We omit that here. This is where it is, the Soul Society, right? So to create this scenario, why would these two people be fighting in the first place, right? Well, I want y'all to think about this while we go ahead and get to explain in One Punch Man, right? So if anyone knows anything about One Punch Man, we know it's kind of a gag show. That sounds really nasty. It's kind of
gay!
A lot of stuff can't be taken in here, can't be taken seriously. But a lot of the feats can be retrospect into the same world of Noragami is, where it's folklore, it's fiction. It's kind of meant to be over the top. So, Atomic Samurai, let's talk about this boy first, right? But, so, Kamikaze is Atomic Samurai's actual name, right? And Atomic Samurai, so in this universe that they have, a ranking from heroes. You know, they call it the Hero Association. Atomic Samurai was four, right? Four.
Yeah, yep. I believe so.
Yep, S-class rank four, right? So you got Blast, King, Tsubaki, Silver Fang, and Atomic Samurai. Now, I know that's five. Blast is technically MIA. So, you know, he was number one, but people didn't know he was dead until just now. But we're going to get into that because we're dealing with manga and anime here. So, Atomic Samurai is definitely the cream of the crop, right? So, some of his special moves, and the most famous one, right, is Atomic Slash.
Atomic Slash.
Actually, we finna go into a video on this, right? He's meant in all of anime. So this is when the Boros invasion and the enemies had came down originally, right? And my boy over here talking that mess. Oh, actually, you know what? And I want to mention this too. So your boy over here talking this mess, but something we're gonna get on later on to the debate is teamwork and camaraderie, which is shown off right here in this clip. But we're going to get back to it, right? So, he has Atomic Slash, which is... shown right here. And actually, you know, we're going to show just his swordsmanship in general. And Atomic Slash, look at this. And this dude be talking mad wet. We're going to get to the character here in a little bit. So... Look at this. Sing. No problem. Atomic Slash. Look at this. Boom. That man literally was like, hey, don't turn your back on me. Bam. This happened, right? We heard of people bisecting people or quadsecting people, right? What is this? Hasaki! So, Atomic Slash is supposed to be over 100 cuts, right? And it is said he's supposed to do that in a blink of a second. And he showed something like that off twice, right? So, he did this and Atomic Samurai.
Wait, can we leave it right here real quick?
Yeah.
Like, what's up? Where's showing that slash?
Oh, you want to go back to it?
No. Right. So, you had it right there where I wanted it on the pause screen,
mm-hmm.
which is... Where it's like showing him actually doing the slice.
Okay, so Max just said something genius. Okay, I got another one here too. Not to disintegrate somebody. Totally, right? We're gonna go back to the slash that my boy X was talking about here, which is. This part right here. What do you want to say about this, X?
So, that move alone, if you get hit with that, you're pretty much donezo, because you need to have that amount of regenerative capability to survive anything like that. Because it's literally in the name. It's not just some, I cut you a bunch of times. No, he's cutting you at an atomic level each slice.
Okay. And that is true. And to kind of jumping off where X is leaving at right now is Atomic Samurai's raw power is nothing to joke about. Once again, Mel's Guard, right? We're just gonna call him Mel, is one of the soldiers, or technically a group of soldiers, that as long as I can be Cupcake Beloved, a group of soldiers that he assimilates into one body, right? So, the only reason that person survived it is because he had regenerative capabilities, right? So, he fought him, right? And then, Black Sperm. Yes, that's his name. Or Black S, right? And Atomic Samurai versus Black Sperm, Black S, showed a lot about Atomic Samurai's character. Y'all are wild. One, Atomic Samurai hates being called weak. This is one thing I want y'all to know when it comes to setting the character. Atomic Samurai does not like weak people. When he met Saitama, once again, Saitama's number one, but before he knows that, Atomic Samurai didn't even shake dude's hand. He was like, hey, yo, I'll shake your hand when you get in the S rank, bro. I don't know. Rude. But he hates being called weak, and he hates other people that he mess with being called weak. So, Black S, once again, let's go to an appearance of what Black S looks like. And this is what he looks like. This is it, right? So imagine Atomic Samurai rolling up on this, like, hey, yo, pig squeak, get out the way. But turns out that Black S is actually, I know there's a number, 53,999,999,999,999,900 cells.
That's a lot of fucking cells.
That's a lot of people. And just to put in the context, that's more people than are on the planet right now. Right? At this moment. Like, that is an assimilation of more people than that. But, you know, at the time, he didn't know that. Atomic Samurai boasts during this fight. And gets... This is the part where I put the little thing where it says... That's when I throw this clip in here, right? Now, he loses this fight, right? But during the later half of this fight, another thing to kind of scale Atomic Samurai into power, which once again is not how many he takes off in one slash, right? It said he killed like 90,000 of them. So inside the One Punch universe, there was, for lack of better terms, one of his best friends. They have a blade called the Sunblade, right? And the Sunblade is one of two mirrored items between the Sunblade and the Moonblade, right? And the Moonblade is nowhere near to be seen. Hold on to that. Let's keep that in the memory. The Moonblade is nowhere near to be seen. But the Sunblade, one of the old heroes, kept it in a pocket dimension hidden in his necklace. And when he died, he gave said necklace, said sword, to Atomic Samurai. I was like, hey, yo, keep this safe. So the whole premise of Atomic Samurai's guild, for lack of better words, is to find this other blade, right? And become the best swordsman. So during this fight, which is now turns up to be Gold S, right? Which is the golden version of this guy. Of Black S. Gold S pushes Atomic Samurai along with another villain, not to get too, talkative about it, pushes him to the part where basically he's taking on Atomic Samurai's attacks. They're nothing. They're nothing at this point. So, realizing they're on the brink of death, he pulls out the Sunblade. But the Sunblade is said to have a mind of its own. He can't pull this thing out, so what he has to do is to clear his mind. And he does this by thinking of Silverfang, another one of the heroes on there. And he ends up pulling out the Sunblade. Once again, telepathically linked. And what he ends up doing with this Sunblade is cutting one of the other heroes' massive energy blast, this guy right here. And this is supposed to be stronger than the sun. This is supposed to imply that the Sunblade cut the sun, split the sun, right? And when doing this, he was able to sever Gold Sperm's, Gold S's arm, which effectively took out a couple trillion of these cells, right? He did that in one swing. The Sunblade started to take a bit of his life, right? So he had to resheath it. But Atomic Samurai basically became God, or half a god here, briefly. Why do I bring this up? Because beforehand, Atomic Samurai was already rivaling Black Sperm's play around power. And then this power spike jump made Gold S get serious just for a little bit. If the whole mind warping thing wouldn't have took place, Gold S would have had to take the gloves off.
Like, he would have.
Oh my god, this is so good. Oh. You have somebody who is able to compete with godly level things, godly level feats such as splitting the sun, at the sake of, for right now at this point in the show, sanity. Right? Getting off of Atomic Samurai and going on the Metal Bat, which is going to be pretty easy to talk about in retrospect, because Metal Bat only has one real big thing going for him, right? And that's this dude's durability. Out of this fight, you're going to notice that Bishamon and Metal Bat are powerhouses. And just the kind of state right now, one thing that's going to be said in the debate that we're going to get into the nitty-gritty after we get done talking to these people, because what we're going to do is we're going to segue into Noragami, a little bit more about that. And then now that I've given you the information, we got some stuff to talk about. But Metal Bat, his main drive is what they call his fighting spirit. So Metal Bat is ranked number 15, right? A good little bit below Atomic Samurai. He has the lowest intelligence rating based on the data book, but he definitely has some combat smarts. I'm gonna start calling this the Goku complex. Metal Bat's real easy to talk about because the main thing he has going for him, like I said, is an insane durability. He's got a slight healing factor, and then his fighting spirit. Now, this fighting spirit that's visualized, and I want to just point out that the same energy-like thing is over his bat as well. Okay, but the more he gets damaged, the more he wants to fight. Now, the downside to this is that once the fight's over, I don't want to say it mentions that he succumbs to the damages or the injuries. I'm not saying, like, if he got his arm cut off, he wouldn't feel it, and then all of a sudden his arm's cut off, right? But it's like, as long as the fight's going, he's not down. That's what it's meant to be implied. So, the biggest thing you could state from this, right, is that this is a fight that when he first started fighting Garu, right, and this one swing on the ground leveled this whole building. The car, this is just the shockwave from the impact, right? And they say that Metal Bat is, they said, large town to small city level swings is how strong he can get. These are just casual swings. Now, this is no Sasuke, right? He's not dimension cutting anything, right? But this is pretty powerful to do with a bat, my homie, right? So it, another thing during this is like he is supposed to be in the One Punch universe. The threats are leveled. Human level threats, dragon level threats, demon level threats, blah 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 blah. Right? Demon level threats are surprisingly not higher than dragon level threats. So he is in a spot right now during this where he's fighting demon level threats, right? And getting smacked around, as you can see. Bink. One hit. Gone. Thing's done. That's it, right? He's even more powerful than before. This is a demon level threat. Single blow, okay? So he takes this damage. He's done. Now, notice in this part, even though he clearly just got whacked around a lot, he's not necessarily phased. He's clearly bloody, right? But he's walking. He's not fatigued. He's not, you know, he's good here to fight, right? So you get on further, and this is where dragon level threat comes out. Elder Centipede is supposed to be the strongest centipede, right? And this monster, lack of a better word, lost to Blast, right? He hits it, does nothing to the exoskeleton. So he was able to wipe out those two things in a single blow. This is to show the difference between a demon level and a dragon level threat. It could one blow these, but this it does nothing, right? Okay. He gets smacked. He's beating that thing with all these hits. The same thing that just one shot this thing, right? And this is supposed to show him getting drugged through the city, right? So he's getting drugged. And then he gets flung, right? So Garou's like, all right, bro, this dude already got beat. I'm finna go. And dude gets up after getting drugged through the city by a dragon level threat. And it's still like, all right, ayo, get out my way, yo. Now, he doesn't know Garou is going to attack him. That's another thing, right? Check the reflexes. He does not know Garou is going to attack him. He does not know he's the hero killer. He's just like, ayo, civilian, hey, I need you to hurry up and get back, right? Garou's like, oh, bet. So he's like, hurry up and evacuate. What they call
Garou at this point? Garou at this point isn't even, like, he's high tier A, but not even at S yet.
I would put him at low S. But that's,
Wait, actually, where's that dog at?
He just beat it, right? Or actually, let me rephrase that.
No, he got stomped out by the dog.
He just lost to it. He didn't get stomped out by it, but yeah. he did lose to it, right?
I mean, he definitely didn't land a hit on.
He definitely didn't land a hit on you, right? You know, a little, you know, but so Garou has fought at this point like 6B. So here's another thing I want to mention too. He's fought 6B tier hunters, heroes, right? 2 A levels, right? And this would be his second S level that he starts to fight. Also, as a side note, he took a kick to the stomach from Saitama, right? A casual kick.
Got slept.
Right? Got slept, right? But the last
time
we
before that, he got chopped, too.
Yeah, and he got chopped. Yeah, going to hit the mask. Where Saitama's going to get the mask. What has Saitama done to anything when he casually hits it? It's basically dead, right? That's the whole point of this. And he survived 2 hits from Saitama. Now, this kind of gives you where Garou's at, and immediately, he's able to block this, right? At the smallest point of the bat. Without seeing this coming. This is pure reaction, right? So, when you get into this fight, he's like, yo, you picking a fight with me, bro? Why are you doing this? Mind you, he does not know it's him. He gets hit. And at this point, this is... Hold on. I definitely got to go back to that, right? He's getting hit worse than these things that just fought him, right? And he's immediately coming back with full swings, right? Enough to miss. These are full-powered swings, or at least ones that, like, he took, because Metal Bat don't do no basic swings, right? So, he is going in. And he's eating all these, blocking all these, right? Now, let me pause the music right here. Because this is pretty important, in my opinion, right? I'll play with you for a bit. Now, mind you, he's not being 100% serious. Garo's not. But Garo's not taking it easy. He's blocking all these, retaliating with swings, right? He's hitting these enough to get Garo's fist hurting, dealing deadly blows that he's eating. Now, mind you, he's down on the ground right now, right? His hands are shaking. His hands, even when fighting Silver Fang, a person over 10 levels higher ranked than him, Garo's hands have never done this. What this implies, this clip right here, the interviewer saying it, Garo him saying it, and the imagery used between his eyes was supposed to signify that if he'd have landed that blow, Garo would have died. To where he just almost ended, like half the season already. And the only reason he did is because this little sister does not like fighting next to him. Now, I want to bring something else up here. Her looks, right? This woman, or this little girl, right, looks a lot like Nora. Who's Nora? Well, we gonna get on to that. And actually, you know what? We gonna get on that right now as we segue into Noragami. And the main thing that I think is gonna play a big, huge part in this fight is that who's gonna be able to withstand more pain and who's gonna be able to off the other, especially when it comes to Bishamon and Metalbat. I think their interaction is probably the most crucial here. But I'm going to tell you how I think the fight would play out, right? But when you get to Yato, in the world of Noragami, right, Noragami is based on, deities, for lack of a better words, right? And a big thing in this is that, their relation to humans is, even though they're humanoid and figure, right? Notice this is based off kind of like a Japanese lore. But these deities are
2 hours later.
Meant to serve a purpose, right? So these are supposed to be the 7 gods of fortune, right? Bishamonten being the fortune or the god of war, right? She's meant to be a god of war. Now, what I like about what they did with this rendition is to show how nice she is, but how much of a terror she is. Like, Jesus Christ, right? So, one big part that I want to hint about this is that if anything were to happen to Bishamon, right? If anything were to happen to Bishamon, because of how this realm is set up, is when they die and they come back, right? Or if they come back, I should say, it's based on how you're remembered. So if, think of it like this way, like most Americans being Christian, for lack of better words, right? Because you have so many people who know the name Jesus Christ, in the context of this, if Jesus Christ were to die, he would be resurrected because there's memories of this person. So if people stop worshiping these deities when they die, then they actually die. There's no need of resurrection and coming back, right? So Bishamon never has to worry about dying because she's one of the 7 fortune gods. She never has to worry about it, right? But Yato, on the other hand, was a god of calamity. He was actually the god that you would wish upon when you wanted something bad to happen to somebody, right? When you wanted to win a war, when you wanted to do this, when you wanted to do that, you would actually call upon Yato or Yabaku, as they would call him, right? So Yato doesn't have people remembering him. He's really bad on his health. The only people that he has close to him are the main antagonist of the show, which is called Father, essentially his creation. And he calls him his father, even though it's not his father. It's the one that made the wish to bring him into fruition and to keep him around, which is going to play a big part in the ending of this fight. Once again, he has, if he dies, that's it, except for Father. And then you have Hiyori, which is like the love interest, one human in here, which is part Phantom, which are the quote-unquote monsters of the show, right? And then you have his regalia. What are the regalia, right? Well, in Noragami, the regalia are the weapons, right? So Yato's regalia, what is this? Y'all see this chat? If I can move this board here. Okay. Yato's regalia is a sword, right? And this sword is a human. In actuality, it's a dead human who gets a chance of, you know, we'll call it reincarnation as well, as a regalia, if he is found by a deity and decided to be used, right? And his name is Yukine. Yukine is just a child, right? Small child, right? Very young, a very young regalia in the sense, and a very young child, right? Who ends up becoming Yato's sword, and coincidentally his most powerful one, right? But this isn't the only one that Yato's ever had, right? So Yato has had, with his creation, another regalia by the name of Nora, right? Or commonly known as Nora, right? The reason she is called a Nora is because in the world of Noragami, when you take upon a regalia, you give it a name. That's how you form the connection, is you give it a name. So Yukine's name is Seki, K-I being his family name, right? This is him giving him an official name, and this creates the regalia. So anytime he wants this weapon, or this whatever it is, he calls it by name. So he calls its name and it comes, right? So he forms this connection with Yukine, called Seki, right? Well, Nora is called Nora because when you create these bonds with regalia, they're supposed to be very symbolic, very, what's the word I'm looking for, X?
It's like a marriage.
Okay, yeah, like a pact, or like a marriage. Yeah, that's a, God, Jesus Lord, X, that was a great one. But Nora is called a Nora because in this show, anytime you have a regalia, if you look on her arm where these symbols are, and she has multiple of them, she has multiple names. She has multiple users. Multiple people have made a pact with her. They call that a Nora. It's the equivalent of giving.
Basically, up your being
name.
Called a hoe.
Like a deity hoe. Yeah, it's like destroying your pact. To most regalia, their names are sacred, right? Noras generally don't care. Nora does not care at all. So this was his old regalia. And then when they separated, Nora basically was like, I'm for everybody at this point, right? Now, Yato has one regalia, Yukine, or at least that gets on to some stuff a little later we're going to talk about. He used to have Nora. Bishamon is a little different, okay? Bishamon has like hundreds, right? It's crazy. So these are just her commonplace ones, right? All these names you see here, right? But everything you see on her is a regalia. Her clothes are a regalia. Her hat is a regalia. Her earring or eye patch, which you'll get to in a little second, is a regalia. Her whip, her pistol, her other pistol, her revolver, her sword, her club, her lion. She has a lion. She rides on a lion, bro. I'm not joking. I can't joke about this. Is a regalia, right? So typically you think, okay, well, this fight is a 2v2, right? But all these things that I'm showing you that are actual people are her regalia. Now, this is the lion, bro. Just lying. He OD. I ain't gonna lie. He kind of OD, right? In Noragami, Bishamon is meant to be, you know, she's a god of war, right? But she is seen as weak by some because she's not tyrannical. She's given these, and these are just the ones she's wearing. She has, like, some scales. She has, like, a broom. She has, like, a whole bunch of these short little daggers that she never uses, but it are these empty souls who have nowhere to go. So she gives them a home, right? That's supposed to be the endearing part about it, is she gives these a home, right? And while she has these other ones, her lead is named Kazuma. And Kazuma is three things. A, it is her love interest, right? B, it is the central hub to all of her other regalia. And three, it is her first blessed regalia or blessed vessel, right?
Bloody OD.
Super OD, bro. Blessed vessels are vessels or regalia that are meant to be on a different level. Kazuma specifically was just a little ear now, right? But now he's supposed to serve as like this big, you know, by his looks, he's nothing but a big earring, right? But he serves as like the central hub to all the other regalia, regulating their power input, their data, their communication. This is Kazuma's HQ, right? He's easily the smartest person on really both of their teams, right? But if you notice from her her other regalia, Kushuna, Fugaha, Reima, Ara, Tashkura, I can't even pronounce her name right, and then Kazuma, you notice ha, 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 and ma, right? Remember I told you Seki, the last two letters signify the family, so why is Kazuma named different? Well, why she does not like Yato is Yato, no spoilers, slaughtered half her family. Gone. Shown, if you want to see why, go, you know, there's no spoiler zone here. Go watch that, right? But throughout that incident, he specifically told Yato that, hey, actually, you know what? He asks, Yato for help. And in that, mind you, this is at the time where Yato is kind of a douche, right? He don't care about nothing at this point in time. And honestly, Kazuma is the reason why Yato's a good guy right now. And he tells him, what you gonna pay that wish with? And Nora, his regalia at the time, goes, he has nothing. Hey, you want to become a Nora? Give us your name. And once again, that's sacred. And Kazuma says, you know what? If I have to give up my name to save her, to save my family, any price is worth it. And Yato hears this and says, get up, man. You can pay me back later. Go show me the problem, right? And he takes care of it for him. This act of love turned Kazuma from this small nail into a blessed vessel, right? He gives up his name, right? So the regalia, as humans, the only thing that they can do is create these borderlines, which are kind of like air slashes, but can serve as a means to confide or to block something off, which are typically spirits. They use this to trap Yato. Seki cannot get to Yato. She calls another regalia. Bishamon's about to end Yato. Yukine jumps in the way. Yukine dies. Or does he, right? He calls his name, and because Yukine did the same thing Kazuma did, which is probably the catalyst for that, doing something to give away one's life for the god that gave him life, as a, I guess, as a sort of appreciation, Yukine becomes a blessed vessel, and she references Kazuma was first this small nail and ended up turning into, once again, by physical appearance, this, right? Who, mind you, it's just an earring, right? I want you to see how powerful that these blessed vessels are. Yukine turns into two blades. So he has two swords now. And when I tell you, this fight is a big reference to how strong Bishamonten is, right? But they go in from this, right? Now, to show how strong that they are and what he does, there is a part in here, right? Mind you, Bishamon trusts Kazuma with her life, right? They've had this love. No spoils.
You don't even know if I can reach that.
No spoils. There's a part in here that was going to get, there was somebody here that was going to get executed for reasons that they didn't want him to. And this execution is supposed to be an anonymous execution by other deities, right? When things started to go awry, one deity was like, hey, no, all this got to stop. And when he brought up his regalia, now everyone knows what he is. And he's got a very powerful regalia. So as this regalia pulls out, they're like, hey, yo, this is this dude's regalia. I can't do nothing against this. Mind you, the coldest nigga in the whole show, right, is like, Bishamon's like, hey, yo, I need you to do this, right? And she's like, I can't do that. And Kazuma's like, you think you can't? Are you sure? And bro, when I tell you all he did was like, look at this. Pulled out the thing. This is her talking to Kazuma. Now, notice this, right? This is Kazuma's purpose. It says, push Kin, another one of her regalias, borderline to the maximum power, right? So it's like, take the limit you put on her and push it, right? This is what he's telling her to do. To take out that. A whip. And she's like, there's no way I can do this, right? I want y'all to see this clip, right? Look at this. Oh, God. Bro, he's like, hey, are you sure? And she's like, yeah, assert your dominance. He's like, bet. And, oh, yo, mind you, the dude's like, yo, blessed vessel, you're an earring. What are you gonna do to me, right? She takes the whip, cuts it. Even she's surprised. Everyone's surprised here. Like, it hit? And he's like, no. And she takes the whip's borderline and crushes something that's supposed to be well above her power. Because Kazuma routed all the energy to this, right? So once again, this is just a whip. Kazuma has done this with guns. Kazuma has done it with swords. Anything that Kazuma holds, what's the word I'm looking for? Not hierarchy. Holds a connection with. He's able to amplify it. He's able, but another way I think this fight would go is what Blight is, right? I'm bringing up Blight because in a very strong reference, Blight is supposed to be what would fatigue or damage these gods. And how it's given to them is it's given through the impurities of the regalias. So that is the danger of taking on so many regalia. Because if I have just this pen as my regalia, this pen's acts out of line. I can manage it. But if I have everything in my apartment as a regalia, if I start to get blighted, I don't know what caused it. When Yato received Blight, it was from when Yuki first decided to be his regalia. And what caused this was, Blight directly is regalia slowly turning into phantoms, which are kind of things that like the evil perspective. And what does that is something as little as wanting to do evil things or remembering their past life in full. So as Yukine is going to try to remember his past life, he gets blighted. Kinne is blighted. And this is what the blight does, right? You see the eyeball and the darkness and the bruise over his arm, right? Yukine is turning into a phantom. And this, in turn, as you saw, is crippling Yato. This is crippling him. Like, it's... Now, mind you, Yato is experiencing this here. And Yato is essentially forgiving him, right? And he's like, look, you can't interact with them anymore. This is what's happening. But he's like, yo, you got me. Like, I'm here with you, yo. See, I granted you a person's name because... This is once again how serious Yato now sees this importance, right? So, this is supposed to be a ritual in which, like, basically, you have to reform or you're gonna die. And Yukine is like, bro, I don't care. And if he gets blighted enough without dying, it kills the other person or it damages them, right? While Yukine was killing Yato, Yato's like, wait, don't do it yet. Don't kill him. I got faith in my boy, right? And so now he's repenting. I broke the windows. I stole the board. I did this. 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 And now that this blight is getting cured, once again, I want y'all to see what this is from, right? I stole a board. I broke a window. I punched old dude, right? Okay, cool. This crippled Yato. And the blight is just as detrimental as what it does to a person, right? Okay. Yato and Bishamon have been fighting for eons, right? So this ain't nothing. But this fight's a little different, right? Something happened, and in layman terms, Bishamon is getting manipulated, right? Another one of her regalia ended up poisoning another one of her regalia, and this has caused Bishamon to be blighted, right? This blight is not just stealing, and also, so another thing with blight too, is blight compounds, right? Blight, once again, is significant enough to the people who are feeling it, and this is the danger of having multiple regalia. Yato gets blighted by Yukine, he cripples himself. She has not only been blighted by one, but other regalia have been poisoned too. So now, the same absolution that Yukine would have to go through, all these people would have to go through, right? And you got some who not necessarily gonna be as forgiven. Oh. Please, please, my lady. We can't endure this pain. Just release us. Then you have one like this.
Please do it.
Release me.
Right? So.
What's happened to her?
She's blighted.
Don't tell me.
I can't believe it. Our lady's been corrupted.
No. This can't be happening.
Nah, bro. You're not going nowhere. Check this.
I don't think so. You're staying right where you are. No, stay back.
Listen.
I don't want you blighted too.
So she knows if they're close, she will be blighted, right?
Did armor this because one of you tainted her.
So one of them tainted her, right?
Who is it?
No one knows. No one knows what happened. Now, check this. She calls him, and he's like, okay, let's go. Here's what she says.
Attack him. If we want to save everyone, we have to kill Yato.
This same thing from one thing crippled Yato. And she wants to get up and fight now that five are blighted. The two guns, the suit she's wearing, this one and this one. Five are affected by this. And she wants to get up and fight still, right? This is the durability aspect that is going to give Metalbat a run for his money, right? So once again, hold on.
He's taking them from me again.
So unlike Yato, her emotions are not under control. Kazuma is not there to regulate any of this power. And it's just compounding. She's getting hurt by it.
Using her regalia even after being corrupted?
thing after being blighted, but Yato is crippled, right? So once again, not to harp on this point here, but I want y'all to understand the difference of the durability of something that's already supposed to be a deity. In what sense, this is what makes her God of War. She's not stopping, right? This is what, beloved, if you're still here, when I said she's a monster, this is what single-handedly makes her a monster, right? Yato's the God of Calamity. He's been in, all he did was grant wishes for wars and cut and kill and fight for eons. That's what he did. That was his job, right? Meanwhile, she's doing the same thing, but never had to worry about getting blighted. Never had to worry about Nora's. Never had to worry about any of this, right? Now, where he's able to fight, she's still this strong. She's still this powerful without Kazuma.
Hey, no, wait!
And she's still fighting. She's a problem. So now that we've kind of gotten all that wrapped up, the only other regalia she has was another blessed vessel when the regalia that housed her clothes died. And this blessed vessel was actually the first blessed vessel, right? And this blessed vessel made up a whole garb, which is going to be real key when we talk about Atomic Samurai and the Sunblade, right? But now, if we're going to get in the context of the fight, once again, we have the Sage Stat. Where are they fighting? Soul Society, right? How do they get there? X, you still here?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay, just make sure. Where are they getting to, right? The Soul Society, okay? How do they get in the Soul Society? Once again, these are two heroes fighting. This is not like the last who you got, once again, Payne versus Lemillion, right? This is a 2v2 setup, and they're technically all good guys. So how are they fighting? The only way that a human, mind you, because these deities can go where they want, that a human can get to a place such as the Soul Society or any place meant to house deities, right, would be interdimensional travel. And the only person on the hero side that easily has access to that is Blast. If I'm going to set the stage, one of two things is going to happen, right? And more than likely, it would be this. Nora, through Father, is always trying to set Yato up to do something corrupted so he can turn into his old ways and kind of come back and fight the bad fight again, right? Nora looks a lot like... from different angles, looks a lot like Metal Axes, right? Or I think could pass by as it. Guarantee you Nora is going to lead this guy here, right? Or Nora is simply going to provoke these deities that they can see, right? Once again, these humans can interact with them. They just can't go where they go. Or, you know, it's the regalia that can't do that, right? But Nora's ability is a, manifestation and manipulation of water. She has been known to trick humans into seeing things. So, guarantee you she would trick Metal Bat into basically thinking that Yato is chasing her. Because Yato would be chasing Nora. Not his sister. So how would they get there? They need Blast. So they say, hey, we got this dragon level threat. These two gods, after seeing these Bishamon and Yato fight in the city, which they're always doing, literally always doing, and basically we need to go get them. So Blast teleports them to Soul Society. Boom. We in the middle of Soul Society, right? We starting a fight. What's happening? So if we think that's how this initial pairup would go, if it's a 2v2, you would initially want to, you know, how we think about 2v2s in a debating comp site is we take two 1v1s, right? Bishamon versus Metal Bat. Atomic Samurai versus Yato, right? There you go, you got our fights. Bishamon and Yato, in this point in the manga, have got a little bit of working together, but not much. Metal Bat and Atomic Samurai do this all the time. That's what they do. They be fighting. So, mind you, they get there, Metal Bat's upset. You got my sister, bro. Like, what's good? Yato's one to ignore people. Yo, I don't know what you're talking about. How can you see me? Metal Bat hates being ignored. Plus, you have a sister. Right? So, now mind you, Metal Bat goes at Yato. Yato's not worried about it at first. Bishamon is. No, he's mine to kill, not yours. Bishamon steps in, right? Then, you have this entity that makes these casual level swings. Atomic Samurai starting to jump in, who can bisect things at an atomic level. Now we got us a fight. Who are you humans? Y'all a problem. Like, we need to handle this. Boom, you got your 2v2 set up, right? Metal Bat, Atomic Samurai is going to separate Yato, because Yato's a swordsman. That's an honorable kind of fight, right? Mind you, Yato's just technically defending himself. So he's like, hey, I mean, if you want it, that's cool. But Yato's not in this mind of, you know, being a god of calamity again, right? Or what he's going to be. He's not in that mindset anymore. So, who is stronger between between Atomic Samurai and Yato? Yato is easily stronger. It's not even close. It's not a comparison at all. Why? The main source of, the main power, right? So mind you, you know, they fight. But if there is any spirit bomb, any Kamehameha, any Gallic gun of Yato's arsenal, right? It's Rend. And what Rend does is it cuts evil spirits. It cuts phantom. It cuts malicious intent. But it does not cut people and good-hearted people, right? So this execution was supposed to be done what's called a divination circle, right? And what this is this is the power of, it's 7 or 10. I'm pretty sure it's 10, right? 10 other of these deities, which is supposed to be the Judgment Council, right? That's supposed to be responsible for executing this person, right? So this thing is energy comprised of 10 to 12 other deities, right? Enough to be, you know, like, these are top gods, right? Mind you, there have only been four blessed vessels in all this show, and Yukine is one of them, right? And a young blessed vessel at that, right? This kills anything it touches, right? And they showed that, right? Everyone's scared. No one survives this, right? Not only does he cut through it with ease, he quad sects the entire circle. There is nothing that Atomic Samurai can do to defend against that, right? Because the only thing that he has that is close to that is the Sunblade. But the Sunblade is only used for a short bit of a time. Can cut through the power of the sun. That's cool, right? That's cool. Yeah, these 12, 13 of the gods. Each one of them holding regulative power to that, right? And he quad-sects that. One Rin, too, right? Because mind you, the mental power of these is what determines all this, right? Excuse me. He quad-sects that. That's it. It's done. It's not even a contest. It's not even a fight. But if you notice how Yato and Bishamon fought, if he never gets a chance to do something like that, there's a fight between him and Rabo. They don't fight on a grand scale, right? They are strong. They are fast. But Yato cannot cut something at an atomic level in thousands of slashes in the blink of a second. He cannot move his sword as fast as Atomic Samurai can do. His energy projection is faster, right? His sword play is just as good. That whole thing that Atomic Samurai did. Just as relative, right? But if Atomic Samurai comes at Yato with that, Yato's not blocking that. Period. Yato is not blocking that, right? Now, through Atomic Samurai's attitude, he's going to rev up to this point, right? He's not going to come out swinging, right? Because that's not his character. Why? Because he didn't do that with Black S, which, by the way, was a demon-level monster. He is in the middle of the monster headquarters and is not going all out. That's in his character. Stupid, but that's in his character, right? He's not going all out. So, he's revving up to this point. Meanwhile, Bishamonten is going crazy over here with Metal Bat, right? And they're trading blows, but this fight is stalemated because, once again, how much power can Metal Bat withstand before he drops? And is that power equal to what he can dish out? So if Metal Bat gets hit with a city leveling whip, right? Does that mean his next swing is a civil leveling whip? No. Because, well, I mean, honestly, actually, now I think about it, it's very debatable. But no. Because even though he doesn't have a cap on how much he can take, it did say that he was still, at least to this point, small city or large town level swings. Now, mind you, this is just swing, right? But Bishamonten is still a god. She still has regalia that are meant to handle all these blasts. Because, once again, the sword, the might that Yukine put out just after becoming a blessed vessel was enough to kill her if it made contact with skin, but through her armor, it wasn't touching. And even though she had just those skimpy clothes on, those are regalia too. And at that point in time, when she was being blighted, already damaged, they were not power capped by Kazuma, right? In this fight, she's gonna have Kazuma. She doesn't have to think about any of that. Kazuma is her equivalent to Ultra Instinct. She doesn't have to think about anything as she's fighting, right? She fights, she tells Kazuma what she wants to do, and Kazuma's just like, beep, 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 got it. Here's a part where I think the fights gets cool, right? Here's where the fights gets cool, right? I'm going to say round one. This is what I mean by round one, right? I don't think Metal Bat, and I thought about this for a while. I do not think Metal Bat or Bishamon do any relevant damage to each other. But I do think that as they stalemate, there's a level of respect. Now, mind you, Blast, by the setting of this fight, is what got them there. Who else is there? The deities can come immediately. All the other seven gods of fortune. Hiyori can come. I know I didn't respond to all the people, but like, there's plenty of other of these deities, as you can see, right? And a lot of them have grown to like Yukine and love Bishamon because she's one of the seven, right? In the middle of this fight, they're going to have an audience, right? There's going to be an audience start to require of these heroes because Blast is getting them there. Because once again, Blast just hears dragon, cosmic, god level threat, right? Gotta go. And all these other deities are just like, hey, yo, what y'all doing over here? Why y'all fighting these little humans? And these humans is pulling up. They have an audience as this fight's going on. Metal Mat and Bishamon are stalemating. It is what it is, right? But Yukine is a child, right? I think round one, Atomic Samurai kills Yato. Once again, Yato is not surviving this. If he gets cut with this, he's not blocking that. He's not surviving that. He dies, right? Now, even though Atomic Samurai can cut through a sword, he's shown visions of other swords. Here's something else I forgot to mention at the beginning, right? What would get Atomic Samurai interested in this? Atomic Samurai, remember, has the Sun Blade. But like I mentioned at the beginning, it's supposed to be a sister to the Moon Blade. And Yukine, surprisingly, through the research and through the lore, looks a lot, or at least when he was One Blade, looks a lot like the Moon Blade. He probably wants his blade, because the Samurai Association takes blades, one, and they are looking for this Moon Blade. If he does this, he's not aiming for Yukine. Mind you, he doesn't know at this point in time, round one, that this is a blade. He understands that the dude wielding it is the problem. Yato gets off a few rins, not no Devastation Circle cutting rins, but he gets through a few rins. He understands it's powerful. Atomic Samurai's like, ayo, all right, stop calling me weak. We ain't getting no games. And he does this to him, and he loses, right? Now, mind you, like I told you at the beginning, if anything happens to Bishamon, she does not die. But if anything happens to Yato, because nobody remembers him, because Nora is not in this fight, because she's setting this up in the beginning, she's probably in the back just lurking anyway, right? Yato dies. But, and here's this whole two good guys are fighting, what happens? I think truly, during Atomic Samurai and Yato's fight, Atomic Samurai has been really close to his disciple, right? This guy, right here. He takes great pride in this one. Here, this is the one that was in the middle of the fight that basically told everyone to run. And he praises him. When he's finna give up, he says, don't lose the way of the samurai. You're too good. Right. Every single person that he has fought, he's always said, basically, GG. Good fight. Guarantee you throughout that fight, Atomic Samurai grows a level of respect for Yato. And between that, between Hiyori, between all the other deities looking on, guarantee you that's going to be enough memory for the shrine that Yato made Hiyori. No spoilers, but for the shrine that Hiyori made Yato, he would be remembered through this here. If we're giving it any rounds, right, Bishamonten in Metal Bat, still over there swinging, Yato dies, right? But Yato comes back. He's a deity. Round two. How does round two happen? How does round two start? Why are we even at a round two to begin with, right? Well, because for one, these are my videos, not yours. I'm just playing.
Fair point.
Two, respectfully, during the incident that caused that, Bishamon risked everything to go get Yato. She risked fighting Izanami, which is the queen of the underworld, went to her place, effed up her castle and all her realm, and almost couldn't make it out just to save a dude that she barely liked, that she started to grow respect for. Yato's gonna do the same thing for her, because he likes Vina. He also owes Kazuma. Now here is where the fight takes its different level. By the end of the manga, Yukine becomes Inora. Yukine gives up his name. No spoilers, I'm not gonna tell you who, but Yukine does so. For reasons. Kazuma gives up his name. For reasons. And just to kind of throw this out here, it's to Yato. Right? To save Kazuma from that, Vina, Bishamon, attempts to sneak off, and she goes get the original Blessed Vessel as a new guard, which almost killed Amaterasu, which was the sun deity, which is once again equivalent to what the Sun Blade does, right? As soon as Yato dies, Bishamon turns on. That's it. At that point, no matter how long that fight pushes out, Metal Bat is not withstanding sun-cutting blows from Nana, which is the first original Blessed Vessel, right? She splits Amaterasu. This is a sun-cutting attack, and what she was, she basically doesn't like any deities, any gods at all, right? But she's working with Bishamon because Bishamon promises a way back at him because Bishamon got some stuff to do. No spoils, right? But Bishamon takes this garb, right? And this whip, which I believe is a liquid sword in actuality, is what did that damage to Amaterasu, right? A metal bat is not durable enough to take sun-splitting attacks. He's not. Because all the attacks that Metal Bat were receiving were not cuts, sex, anything of that nature. They were blunt trauma blows, right? And mind you, that metal bat is unbreakable. That's, you know, that's fine. And he can, I think he could, metal bat can block, because he's shown it with Garu, right? As fast as Garu is, right? He can block Bishamon's attack for days, because once again, they're not putting out the speed that Atomic Samurai does. They're not putting Pewee Pewee prisoner speed out. They're not. Metal bat calls that slow. But what he is not doing is withstanding the power of something that could split the sun. When Yato dies, Bishamon turns on. She calls this. Kazuma at that point is still there. She has two blessed vessels. That's GG, period. Done. We ain't even got to talk about nothing else with that, bro. That's two blessed vessels. GG. Y'all see what Kazuma did to the other one with a whip? Hello? Like, that's GG. That's it. That's rap. Meanwhile, Yato is coming back for Bishamon, right? Where's Yukine in all this, right? Yukine gets released, right? Because when they die, the regalia go as well. But once again, Yukine became a Nora. Once again, for reasons, but so who's going to pick up Yukine? Bishamon loves Yukine because she is the only true thing that has stuck by Yato paper and thin, and she believes that Yato needs that. He's picking her up for the meanwhile, and if not, once again, these regalia can turn into human-like forms. He's out of there for a little bit. But he's coming back. And when he does get there, the first thing that's going to happen is Kazuma's going to say, ding, ding, I see Yato. He's alive? Where? I don't know how. I don't care. The audience we have must place him in Myriad. Doesn't matter, Vina, anywhere, Yato's here. And Bishamon's going to say, find him now. There goes the earring. It's gone. Yato has made bonds with Kazuma. He's going to find him. And when he does, Yato's going to have Kazuma to go do what? To find the fight and to find Yukine. And when you put the kind of power that Yukine was cutting those divination circles with behind the power capping, scaling, and manipulating power that Kazuma has, that's GG. That's GG. Anytime you get two of these blessed regalia together, it's GG. It's period. That's why they don't do it in that manga. Right? That's it at least yet, right? It hasn't taken place, right? But in this kind of situation, it would. Because you have a god who just died, a god who's all of a sudden fighting for her life and fighting for the Revenger One, regalia that don't know what's going on, and Kazuma that is mainframing all this as it happens. So as Kazuma is like, hey, yo, we gotta survive here, and he's helping her survive in the meantime, as soon as Yato gets into play, and Yato gets back, he's on headcut mode. God of Calamity's back at that point. Because he just died. He literally just almost lost his life. How is he back? He doesn't know how he's back. But he does understand that somebody would have to have remembered him. And it can't be his regalia, because in the world, the memory of the people from the near shore can't operate like that. So you can't be alive because of that. It's the heroes he just fought. He would know that. So guess who's going to come back and give that guy an honorable fight? Dude's going to realize that he did not find the Moonblade. He's going to be stuck with just the Sunblade. And even if the Sunblade maintained control, you see it starting to melt with his arm, right? The part of the lore was that the one who wields both the Sun and the Moonblade will have a parallel power to a legend, right? At this point in the fight, they have two blessed vessels. They already have their Sun and Moonblade. That's it. I thought real hard and long about this, and I could have sworn Metal Bat would have been the deciding factor between who decides to get both of them. Because as this does happen, Metal Bat and Atomic Samurai have so much more foundations of teamwork that the two deities, Yato and Bishamon themselves, had. If it gets 2-2 between any one of them, it's fine. Because Metal Bat's going to take all the hits. Take all the hits. Atomic Samurai is fast enough to blitz them both, right? But the difference is Kazuma operates at light speed. No matter where he hits, Kazuma buffs those areas on her body. Kazuma buffs that armor, and the armor that she had is already a blessed vessel who knows how to fight between multiple deities, not just one human at that, right? And then Yato comes back. Kazuma goes to find him. That's it. It's GG. At that point, everyone's dead. All the humans in that place, gone. Everybody. No one's withstanding three blessed vessels. All those gods couldn't handle one at a time in multiple occasions, right? And the only reason that this starts is because technically Atomic Samurai won the first fight. I do think Atomic Samurai, before that moment, would have beaten Yato. He'd have speed blitzed him. Yato can't block it all. That's it. He dies. But for reasons of Atomic Samurai's character in general, he's going to honor that and be kept in his memory. And in that context, Yato would come back. Even if this was a 1v1, Yato's still going to come back. And at that moment, he's not in God Calamity mode. And if this was a 1v1, when he gets back, he's in GOC mode. That's it. He's offing people. No more games now. No more games. He's never had a blessed vessel in kill mode, right? All you need is kill. He hasn't been at that moment. If I'm going to wrap this up and say, who you got is Team Noragami overall. If we took this to a round three, Team Noragami wins for that point alone. I will proudly give round one to Atomic Samurai Metal Bat. I will give that fight to Atomic Samurai Metal Bat. But if we talk about the war, the battle, to death, who you got? I got Team Noragami. So there you got it, guys. That's the who you got. That is my take on Metal Bat and Atomic Samurai versus Bishamon and Yato. Okay. A lot of people have not seen Noragami. Please don't sleep on it. But I'm going to try my best, guys, to keep on with the videos, to keep on the who you got. Like I said, life took a big change for me. But I'm back, and I'm here. I got gameplay content coming of all kinds. Valorant, Naraka, some Overwatch, Overwatch 2 when it comes out. Hopefully Overwatch 2 for the PvE is going to be really exciting, because I'm really excited about that. You know what I mean? Blaze Blue, I might bring back first five Tuesdays. Might change the day, but, you know. And then who you got? You know, I got some ideas. Phantom Media, Noel, Sundrip Woo, Miriam, you know. Any recommendations, requests, please throw it in the comments. Throw it in the... Thank you guys for being so patient with me. And to those of y'all who's always supported me, I know who y'all are. I love y'all. And let's keep on with it, okay? Yerski! Peace out.